Thank you for keeping the flies alive.
Disco Daddy's Wide World of Hip Hop would like to send a big shout out to the First Lady of Hip Hop, MC Sha-Rock. Sharon Jackson, as a pioneering female, you set a standard and opened doors. We may never fully gauge the depth of your influence on hip hop as a culture. Salute with full honors, Queen Sha-Rock.
So nice, so that's what I like. Is that
I say it here, how can you just don't stop it and just get ready to jam? The Disco Daddy Wide World of Hip Hop Radio Show. Every Saturday at 1 p.m. Pacific Time, only on 5Live.com with special guests every week. Don't miss it.
Hello out there, Disco Daddy here. Welcome to another episode of Disco Daddy's Wide World of Hip Hop. And as you know, all September, we're honoring and paying tribute to our sisters in hip hop, the queens of our culture, hip hop culture. They've been down with us since day one. Their stories many times are minimized, overlooked, or not told at all. So, we're blessed to have lived long enough for something called the internet to come along. And now we have worldwide radio, and we can get some of these ladies' stories out. Hip hop is one of the only genre, culture-wise and musically, in which the founders are still living. And you're about to hear from one of these ladies, these first-generation queens. Her name is DJ Lady Love. She's going to tell her story and give us a flavor of what was happening at the time when she was a young spring chicken just fighting in her teeth, getting it into hip-hop and what it was like, what was going on, okay? So DJ Lady Love, welcome to Disco Daddy's Wide World of Hip-Hop, and we want you to just start back to the very beginning where you were born and grew up, and what was going on that made you decide to take the path that you walked on, where you became what you are now, a hip-hop queen. DJ Lady Love, y'all, on Disco Daddy's Wide World of Hip-Hop.
Hey,
you got it.
Disco Daddy and everybody. I'm DJ Lady Love, and I was born in the 60s, so, you know, in the Bronx, Fordham Hospital. I'm a BX girl, and I love the Bronx, everything about the Bronx. So, but...
Right.
At the age of 12, we moved. My mother moved a lot. She was in like a lot of abusive relationship, in an abusive relationship. So, from the Bronx, we moved to Cleveland. From Cleveland, we came back to New York. I lived in Brooklyn. I lived in Harlem. I lived in every borough in New York except for Staten Island. And then, by the time I was 15, we settled in Queens. So, Queens, and so that was where my teen year started in Queens. Like I said,
What year is this? You settled in Queens.
We settled in Queens in 1972.
Okay.
And so with all the moving and stuff, I was not a very outgoing person. I more was into reading, and my music was my love. My mother gave me a radio when I was like 10, a portable radio, and I used to listen from one end of the station, WABC, to the other end of the station, WWRL. So I had the best of both worlds. And my mother,
the Big RL.
Yep.
I remember the Big RL. I was born and raised in New York, too. Frankie Crocker, he was my inspiration to become a DJ. Wow.
I went from one end of the spectrum with Cousin Brucey to the rest. So my love of music came from that. And like I said, I was a quiet child. I really didn't have too many friends. And then high school was difficult. And then I got pregnant at 16. Well, 15.
Ooh.
I had my son when I was 16. So
okay.
I was kind of lost. I was really lost. I didn't know what direction. I dropped out of high school. 6 months before graduation, I dropped out of John Adams.
Wow.
I went to Murray Bertram High School. I got accepted into there. It was the first year. I would have been a first year graduating, first graduating class. And
okay.
I got pregnant, dropped out, ended up going to John Adams, dropped out. I was lost. And so
okay.
this one year, it was like 1978, and I heard that there was a party, and I didn't used to go to parties. And something
mm-hmm.
was like, go. And I went by myself to this party, and it was a basement party.
Queens or the Bronx? Where was it?
In Queens. I lived in Queens
okay.
then. So I'm going down. The music was banging. I'm going down the stairs, and I'm like, wow. And there was a light in the corner of the room. It was a house. So the guy, he was playing in front of the laundry room.
Okay.
And so I go over and I see this guy. Now, I had cousins who were DJs, so I know what DJs did, but they were
okay.
disco DJs. They didn't have two copies of records and all of that. They had one record of each one, and they would, you know, mix.
Right.
They didn't
right.
do anything else but that. That's all they did.
Right.
So I see this guy on a turntable, and he's going back and forth with the same record. And he's in
revolutionary at the time, I could imagine.
Yeah. I was amazed. I couldn't believe what he was doing. And the song that he was playing was Apache. I found that out later. But
okay.
he was just doing it. And I stood in front of this guy the whole night. I didn't move. I didn't go anywhere. I just stood there.
Really?
And when he was finished, he said, yo, you've been standing here all night. Something wrong with you or something? I was like, no, I want to know how to do that. What you doing right there, I want to know how to do that. And he said
wow.
to me, he said, come to my house after school tomorrow and I'll show you. That dude turned out to be Davy D, who later became Davy D.
Wow.
Next, who did One for the Trouble and who now plays with Public Enemy.
Wow.
He was my first intro into me wanting to be a DJ.
Let me ask you, how old was Davy D at that time, approximately?
You know, I don't know. We were both in high school. So I think we were like the same age.
Okay, you were both in school. Okay, high school.
Yeah.
Okay.
And
okay.
so at the time, he had a crew. And his crew mm-hmm. was called Solo Sound. Those guys turned out to be the Afros. They had a hit called Feel It. And also DJ Hurricane, the DJ for the Beastie Boys, he was part of
right.
that crew too.
Okay.
So
Queens, let me just interrupt you for a second. Queens
mm-hmm.
78 was having its own burgeoning, because we hear, and the reason I have to do this, we hear a lot about what was happening in the Bronx. This is 78. You're giving us a picture of Queens. It had its own fledgling or flourishing hip hop
yep.
movement going on. Okay, so go ahead.
That's right. So
mm-hmm.
Dave taught me. He was so patient. I used to have to wait, but see, Dave at the time he was doing that, but he also played in a band. So when he would leave to go to band practice, he would let me stay, and I would practice. And I used to have to wait till Hurricane and them finished, and I used to get my turn, and then I just became more and more of like this fiend. I wanted more. There was this club in Queens called the Fantasia. I would go wherever there was something, I would go. I know one night Grandmaster Flash came, and that was the first time I saw him, was at the Fantasia. And he came.
What year? What year was this?
What year was that? The end of 78, going into 79.
Okay.
And it was the first time I saw Grandmaster Flash, because he came. This is before I started going to the Bronx by myself. This is like
okay, but you had heard of him. I mean, the names were familiar to you, but you just never seen them.
Names were familiar, but I never saw them. I heard people talking. I heard Dave and them talking about it, but I never saw him. The first time I saw him, was at the Fantasia. He came with Melly Mel, and Curtis Blow played that night too. So I mean, Queen, everybody says, you know, they got their hip hop start wherever. Mine for me was Queen.
Gotcha.
So it started with for me with Davey D.
And let me ask you something else, because this is very, that's why we're interviewing people like yourself. Curtis Blow did that show. Now, at some point, he began working with Russell Simmons. Was he more active, even though Curtis is from Harlem, was he more, and I know he probably bounced around back then, but he was one of the few who could go to Harlem, Bronx, and being Queens, you understand what I'm saying? And,
yep,
and he was so to just give us a picture right quick of the impact he had there in Queens, because we hear a lot, you know, especially on you. I mean, did he become a frequent performer there in Queens?
Yeah, he was like I said, Queens had, we had the Fantasia, we had La Chalet, we had the Olympia Palace, and a couple of little things in between, and they all would come out. Love Buck Starsky came out there. Flash, like I said, came out there. It would just be Flash and Melly Mel. It wasn't until maybe later that we had the Furious. The Funky Four came out there, and Powerhead went out in the Fantasia one night. So the Funky Four rocked down the street in a park. That jam that was going on, because the Power had went out in the Fantasia.
Now, was MC Sha-Rock with them at that time, or was just the Funky Four?
Sha-Rock was with them at the time.
Okay, so you got to see her also in Queens.
I got to see Sha-Rock, that's right.
Wow.
And then, Queens became just, I started knowing everybody. I made friends with everybody. I made friends with a guy named DJ Woody Wood, who's the one that gave me the name DJ Lady Love. And I started venturing out. I would jump on the train by myself and go to the Ecstasy Garage. I saw the Cold Crush. I saw, oh, my God, I saw a Busy Bee. I saw all these people. I was a fiend. I did not care if no one would go from Queens to the Bronx with me. My girls were scared. No, we're not going to the Bronx. We're not going on a train by ourselves.
Jump on that F train. Yeah. Okay.
I didn't care. It got so bad that my mother kicked me out of the house because I refused to make curfew. I had to be at the band. You know?
Right.
And
it was
like a drug for me. That's how much I loved it. I didn't care about anything else.
Okay.
It was just that.
Okay.
And I did it enough to where, like, Flash would see me. I would find out where, and, you know, there was no internet, so it was word of mouth and stuff where the next gig was or where the next, or the flyer. Flash would see me 1 minute, I would be in Queens. Then he'd be in Brooklyn next week playing, and I'd be standing right in front of him. Then he'd be in Harlem somewhere, and I'd be standing where he was like, didn't I see you? And I'd be like, yep. And he was like, he said, "You, where do you live?" I said, "In Queens." I said, "But I want to do that the way you do it." And I told everybody that's all I wanted to do.
Okay.
And eventually I ran into this guy named Man Diplite, and he actually would put me on flyers in the Bronx at the T Connection and stuff like that. So he did a lot of flyers for me and put me on and gave me that break that I didn't just play in Queens.
Wow. Did you hear and meet any of the Mercedes ladies at the time?
Oh, I actually never met them, but I heard of them. Baby D they came to Queens one time. And before they came, I had heard that there was this all-female crew in the Bronx. And when I saw her, I was so amazed because I kept thinking, because in Queens, it wasn't really, it was just me. All the time I went any place, I was the only female. So
That's huge.
Right, in Queens. And so when we would talk, me and Woody would talk, he would always be like, yo, you got to be like more like Baby D. You got to be like, and she was like my idol. I tell her now. I said, you were my Shiro. You were my D-Day. I knew that if there was another female out there doing it, then I could do it too. And I always give her Baby D, like, her props, because no females was doing it like that. Dudes didn't want us on their turntables. So we had to get to make a way on our own. And the Mercedes baby definitely did it.
Okay. So at some point, you get your own equipment, or how does it evolve to you start making your presence felt?
I used to play on, practice on, because Woody was a DJ too. So I would practice on Woody's equipment. And the first time I played at the Fantasia, I was so nervous because I have handed out flyers at my whole old high school, John Adams. And
What year is this?
It was 78, the first time I played. 78. Anything. Yeah.
Okay.
So Cut Creator went to my high school, too. He went to John Adams also. So I handed out flyers to everybody. Nobody even really knew who I was. They didn't even know I went to the school because I really didn't say anything to too many people.
Right.
So my first time getting on, the Fantasia had a DJ booth that you had to step up into and you could look down at the crowd. I was so nervous, my hands were shaking. I look out in the crowd and I see these people from my high school and I see all these people. So the first time I pushed the needle off, I did it too hard and it went straight across the record. And I was just, I could have just turned and walked away, but I didn't. I said, you know what, if I don't do this, I'm not going to do it. And I did. I started, Woody was like, start over. I started over, and I rocked the crowd. And when I finished, everybody was clapping, and they was like, see, I told you you could do it. But that issue one was a make or break, because if I didn't, I probably would have never continued to do it.
I got you.
This love, this hip-hop, it saved me because I found something. I was so lost before I had that. And my mother, even though she thought that I was out of control, what she didn't know was it saved me. It gave me something. It gave me a purpose. I felt like I was a part of something that I never felt like I was a part of before.
Well, let me ask you something. Did you and your mom ever reconcile? Did she ever start seeing or hearing that her daughter was becoming the first female DJ that was really making some waves in Queens?
My mother, it took her a long time because, you know, after a while, I kind of left. And when I decided to she had told me, she said, I didn't know how much you loved it. She said, if I had known how much you loved it, I would have been behind you more. She said, I thought it, because she thought, she would always say, oh, this is a fad, it's going away. Why? What are you saying? Nothing. She would go, it's not going to last. And she said all of that. And when she sat down and she said to me, she was like, I'm really proud of you because no matter what I said, you didn't stop. You just kept going. You was going to, you know, you were going to do this no matter what. And I said, I was. I loved it. And she realized how much the music meant to me. And she actually apologized. She said, I'm sorry. Yeah, I was in tears. She was like, I'm sorry.
I can imagine.
I didn't know what that meant to you.
Wow.
So,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So you start doing this. Records start being recorded. Go ahead. You get
The first time I got invited to the Disco Twins were doing an award show. Baby D.
Okay, explain who they are for the audience out there.
Disco Twins. There were like three big crews that had massive equipment in Queens. There was King Charles, there was the Disco Twins, and there was Infinity Machine. They always would battle. The Disco Twins had the Birthers, which was these huge, humongous speakers and earthquakes. They would shake the walls wherever they played at. And so they had a thing where they had a DJ award, the first annual DJ award show. And there was a whole bunch of people on there, and Baby D and I were the only two females on this It had Flash. It had Theodore. It had many different.
What people. Year? What year was this?
This was 1980s, I think. I have the flyer on my wall.
Okay.
This was, I think it was, matter of fact, it was May 15th, 1981.
Wow.
And
okay.
It had Grandmaster
You're well established Flash. By that time.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Grandmaster Flash, Curtis Blow, Sweet G, The Crash Crew, Bam Bada, Sesame, Baby D,
wow.
Eddie Cuba, Hollywood, Disco Twins, The Fitting Machine, King Charles.
Everybody. Every Queens has become. Queens had become one of the areas where hip hop was definitely
yep.
blowing full blast by 81.
It had Grand Wizard Theodore, DJ Smalls, DJ Lady Love, The Treacherous Three, and Sweetie G. And we were going to get awards. So I was playing. I was on the turntables when Afrika Bambaataa and Jazzy J and them came in. So when I stepped off from playing, they came up to me and they said, if you come to the Bronx, I'll let you get on at the T-Connection. I was like, don't play with me.
Bambaataa said this?
Yes.
Bambaataa said this?
I will be out there next week. And the next weekend, I had my records, and I came out there, and I played at the T-Connection, and after that, I played again, but I was on the flyer.
So that was the first time you had been outside of your comfort zone and went to the BX.
Right. That's right.
Wow.
As far as
okay.
I had been there just to be there, but as far as
right.
being on the
right.
table, that
well,
was it.
And they accepted and, you? Did it go over well?
Yes, it
wow.
did. The group that was on stage, I didn't know at the time, it was actually the Funky Four. And I was a little nervous because the T-Connection DJ booth was up in the air being held up by chains. And it
wow.
was like, it was
wow.
new. So I yeah. kind of got nervous. And Sha-Ross, and I didn't know it was her at the time, she said, we don't know who the DJ is up there, but we're going to let her get herself together, and then we're going to do our thing. So you know, I had to get myself together to do my thing. So, and that was... I also did something with Curtis Blow, Spoonie G, Funky Four, and Woody Wood with special guest Infinity Machine because they did it because they had the 50,000-watt disco system. But we did
wow.
that in Hartford, Connecticut, and that was on April 6, 1980. That was an Easter Sunday.
Okay, let me pause you right there because I got to ask. When you first were getting into it, 78, 70, around that time, before records, just before records, everything mm-hmm. basically is localized. Most of the people, every now and then, people like you went from Queens to the Bronx or vice versa, but basically people stayed in their areas.
Yeah.
And then up until everything started going full blast, maybe 1980, 81, then there was constant travel between hip-hop communities from the Bronx to Queens back to Manhattan. People were traveling and moving around by that time. Is that sort of the picture?
Yeah. I mean, you've
okay.
seen people...
That's important.
Like I said, yes, because when I would go to the Bronx, I would go alone. There wasn't too many people from Queens going to the Bronx stuff. Or it wasn't
right.
too many people from the Bronx coming to Queens unless
the
they were
okay.
Fantasia or something like that. And then they would leave as soon as they finished playing.
Okay. So do you think that because you had these big places, Fantasia, these other big clubs that started attracting attention, that possibly Queens was the impetus for people to start moving and coming, let me go over to Queens and see if we can do, you know, and from Harlem, and then probably clubs opened up in Harlem World, from what I understand, and they
yep.
were now venues, they were now hip-hop venues that you guys can travel back and forth. Is that
yep.
sort of the way that developed?
I believe so. Like, the Bronx
mm-hmm.
blew it up. The Bronx really blew it up. And it made,
right.
because there was everything was happening, and
mm-hmm.
here in Queens, we got to see some stuff. But if you went to Harlem World, if you went to the T-Connection, it was a whole different atmosphere. a whole it's a whole different everything.
Okay.
So everybody kind of started like mixing of the boroughs for me because we from Queens, we would go to Brooklyn, and people from Brooklyn would come to Queens. So it just became this mix where before, you know, everybody stayed in their own borough and nobody really traveled outside their borough and stuff like that. With the hip-hop, look, even though it wasn't called hip-hop, it was, we was going to the jam. And, you know, it became, the city became more open. Everything became more. Everybody would travel, starting to travel to go do these things.
Right. That's beautiful. Now that what you just said right there is probably one of the biggest knowledge bombs because the world's, you see, you guys, first thing I got to say this, you guys are from New York, whatever borough you're from, you grew up hashing all these stories around and you know this back and forth. But when you step outside of New York, everything that you just said and everything that I'm going to show that you guys say are revelations. Nobody knows any of this, how the evolution, you know, all we know is Curtis Blow came out with this record called The Break. We don't know his history.
Wow,
we hear about the female you see what I'm saying? We don't know all of this about the mixing of how hip-hop spread from one borough to another or sprang up in different ways in each borough. And then later on, with the opening of clubs, you guys started traveling, going to each other's clubs and stuff, and it became a community. You see, instead of a localized parts and stuff like that. Very, very revolutionary what you're saying now, DJ Lady Love. So now, let's continue. Records come off.
It was so much going on because at one point you had Curtis Blow and Run from Run DMC. He was the son of Curtis Blow, and he was Curtis Blow's DJ. You know, so you had all of this stuff going on. It was
he called himself the son of Curtis Blow, but he wasn't really, right?
But he was younger brother. You know, so there would be times Woody and I would be finished up and we go to the White Castle on Hollis Ave and we go there and Curtis Blow and Runner be in there. Everybody meet up at the White Castle on Hollis Ave. So it was like a small, you knew everybody.
Right. Okay. That's beautiful. Okay. So now records come out. You got in the game just before recording contracts. Records come out, and all of a sudden, how does that change the game there in New York? Instead of people doing things for fun in the parks and stuff, now everybody wants a recording contract or what? What kind of impact did the recording have?
I didn't act like I left the game in 81. So, I left in 81 because it started getting harder and harder. Before, everything was good because it was new to everybody. By 81, you had problems getting paid, doing gigs. You had janky promoters. You had it just became for the money. The money stuff started to come out.
Wow. So I
kind of stepped back. But I remember the first rap record I heard, you know, Enjoy Records was putting out rap records. They had Clash and them was super rapping, Tetris 3. You know, everybody was on Enjoy before they were Sugar Hill. And to tell you the truth, the first time most of us heard Sugar Hill, we was like, what's that corny mess they playing on the radio? everybody thought it was like this corny song. And then when I heard him say that he was the CASN, the OVA, I'm like, wait a minute. I know that rhyme. And I'm like, I've seen Grandmaster Caz.
Grandmaster Caz.
At the Ecstasy Garage. And I thought, what's going on? But
I gotta pause you because again, this is something you growing up with, y'all know back there that the Grandmaster Flash, and now I guess it's sort of out there in the public, Grandmaster Flash lent his books when Sylvia Robinson was putting together Sugar Hill Gang's the Big Bang Tank. And he took those words, but you had seen Grandmaster Caz call himself and do that rhyme, I'm Captain Overfly. Wow. That's historic what you're saying. You understand what I'm saying?
At first I thought Chaz was on the radio when he was. I'm serious. But that don't sound like Chaz. But those are Chaz words. And so the people who knew all of this, we knew. But then all of a sudden, the record blew up, and everybody was talking about every corner. You heard the Sugar Hill blasting. You heard Rapper's Delight everywhere, no matter.
Same what. Out here in the West, right? Okay, very impactful record.
Yes, I mean, I started to like it too, but I know when I first came, when it first came out, I was like, why don't Flash and them have us? Because Flash and them super rapping to me was the best rap song I had ever heard at the time. And so when I heard this on the radio, I was like, well, how'd they get on the radio? Yeah. So so now, even nowadays, when people tell me, well, their introduction was the Sugar Hill Gang and Rapper's Delight, I'm like, but that wasn't, there was way stuff going on way before then.
Way before then. And you were part of that. So now, we've got a few minutes left. You dropped some bombs, some knowledge bombs, and that's one of the real joys that I get out of doing interviews besides helping you get your story out there. There's things that only you know, that you've seen, that you can verify, that other people have said. You see what I'm saying? You were there, you were part of, and you've illuminated a very important part of that history, that transition period just before everybody was just doing the park jams and stuff and parties for fun, to now there's records, there's money, janky promoters coming from under rocks, you know what I'm saying, crawling out and cheating people and stuff like everybody. So the game changes around 79, 80, 81, and you step out. You obviously had a child. So tell us about you. You got probably had family. I'm a grandfather now. Your grandmother, what is DJ Lady Love doing in the next 3 or 4 minutes that we got?
I have 4 kids, and my kids grew up with me blasting music, playing music, telling them about hip hop. Oh, I know Curtis Blow. Oh, I know this one. How come you don't go back and do it? And I would be like, nah, ain't nobody going to remember me. I'm good. Ain't nobody going to remember me. So now with everything going on, my son was like, I told you. My son who I had when I was 16, there's a flyer that was on his birthday, October 17th, 1980. He said, well, I know where you was at on my birthday, Mom. And Grand Wizard Theater, because I see it on the flyer every time I look at it. So,
wow.
You know, they might be in the household, like I said, with a hip-hop mom. And so their friends would hear songs, and my kids could tell them who sampled it, when they sampled it, because they grew up with me. So they know the game, because I used to talk about it all the time. And so, like I said, now that I did this comeback and stuff, my kids are so proud of me. They was like, we wish you never quit. You should have stayed. But we're glad that you're back and you're happy. So hip-hop saved me.
I've watched you on Facebook. I've listened to some of the things that you're doing. I remember when you said, I'm coming back. I'm going to start doing this again. I said, who is this lady? Okay. And obviously, from other hip-hop people I've talked to or got to learn, you're well-respected. We want to thank you, DJ Lady Love, for your contributions to hip-hop. You're a true queen of the culture, okay? We want to send you, like all of the ladies, all of the queens are getting gold embossed, specially printed letters of recognition with your name on it that's suitable for fame. Yes, we're going to. So when you hang up, when the show ends, just stay on the phone so my producer can get the address. And all of you queens are getting this. Do you understand? We're doing more than just putting an interview on. You're going to have something that's lasting that children and grandchildren can see that there are people who appreciate what you've done. Our hip-hop family worldwide appreciates what you've done. Okay?
You don't make me cry on this show.
That's a lot of ladies said that. Usually it's not for that reason.
Thank you so much.
I'm proud to be able to do this, that God has kept me alive and kept you alive to share this moment together.
Exactly.
Okay?
Exactly.
All right. So what do you think of today's? We've got about 60 seconds left of today's hip hop. Do you have any opinion on what this culture has evolved into?
this is how I look at it. When we were young, we did our thing our way. It's their turn. But you know what? We still got to show them what hip-hop is. This is why I still do what I do. They still need to see where this came from, like what you're doing now. We, this hip-hop community, we brought this to y'all. So don't dismiss us. Just, you know,
learn the history.
Do everything that you do, but don't dismiss the elders, the founding fathers who put this together for you to be able to do this. This everybody just have respect, and we can't always be like, "Oh, that's garbage music." That's what they like.
Yes.
So everybody got to respect everybody and respect the game.
Okay. On that note, we're gonna leave it. DJ Lady Love, she's on Facebook. Okay, and you can check her out on social media and follow her, and she's.
I've been asked to do that, but I don't know.
I hear you. Don't worry about it. They've got internet radio now, and there's going to be more people calling you for interviews. DJ Lady Love, we thank you again for everything that you've done for hip-hop. You're a true queen of the culture.
Thank you very much, and I'm glad not to be forgotten. I appreciate you.
No, you never will be, especially by Disco Daddy's Wide World of Hip-Hop. Thank you all for tuning in. Check us out all of this month as we pay tribute and honor the queens of our worldwide hip-hop culture. Peace.
Hello, I'm Robin Lynn Maven, the CEO, creator, and producer of Vibes Live. We have over 2 million geographical listeners reaching 200 countries with nonstop music 24/7. Just tune in on VibesLive.com.
'Cause Disco Daddy here. Welcome to Disco Daddy's Wide World of Hip Hop. As you've been following us, you know that all September, this show is dedicated to the queens of our culture, hip hop culture, which is now a worldwide culture. Many of you don't know that there have been queens, sisters who have been down with hip hop from day one, and many of their stories have never been told. One of my missions in life and the dedication. The mission of my show is to dedicate the time for the history of these people and their stories to be told. That's what Disco Daddy's Wide World of Hip Hop is all about. Today, our show is dedicated to a lady I call the First Lady of Hip Hop. Her name is MC Sharon Shyrock Jackson. I know she's out there listening. She's involved in a project right now, which the publicity will be released very soon, so she could not be with us. But I told her that her presence will be felt every show. She's going to get a shout-out for every show. And to show how unselfish that queen is, she wanted all of the ladies that are appearing on the show this month to get their stories out. She said that these are all my friends, and many of their stories have never been told. So that's just how she is. I interviewed her a few months back, but she wants them to get the spotlight, and that's the way it's going to be. We're dedicating all September to queens of the culture. Today we have one. Her name is Kimber Reynolds. If you don't know her story, you will. And she predates records. In fact, most of the legendary people that we have on our show predate when records were first starting to be made, because there's a whole history of hip-hop many of you do not know, even people who follow hip-hop. So these are stories that have to be told, because hip-hop is a genre in which all of the founders, basically, most of them are still living. It's a very unique moment in time. But 50 years from now, there'll be academics and scholars digging up interviews like this with people like this who haven't written books yet. And their story now, because of the internet, can be preserved. So, Ms. Kimber Reynolds, a queen of hip-hop culture, welcome to our show.
Thank you.
And I'm sorry for the long introduction, but this is a very special month, all month dedicated to you ladies, okay? In addition, you're going to be getting a golden boss letter suitable for framing, not a little tiny note, but a letter specially printed with your name on it recognizing your contribution to hip-hop culture. Okay, so after the show, hang on and give your address to our producer, Ms. Robin Lynn, and that's going to be handled the week that your interview airs. There'll be a promo post made on all the rap pages with your picture and the picture of your letter right beside it, explaining who you are and directing people to your interview to hear your story. So we want you to start at the very beginning. Just relax and tell us from the very beginning where you grew up, where you were born and raised, and take us up to the moment that you got into hip-hop.
Well, I was born in New York. My dad was born in Jamaica, and my mother's family is from Morocco. I actually grew up in the Bronx. Let's backtrack. I actually, at a very young age, was living in Westchester County with my mother and father in North White Plains in the town of North Castle. But at some point, they decided to split, and so my mother moved to the South Bronx, 1031 Freeman Street, apartment 2E. So we lived in South Bronx during the 1960s when it really was the South Bronx. I was probably blocks away from Southern Boulevard at a time when, you know, the Civil Rights Movement was in effect.
I went to Theodore Roosevelt High School there in 68, Theodore Roosevelt, right on Fordham Road. Castle hamburgers all day long. But go ahead, Kim.
68, I was nowhere close to high school, but
okay.
I was still in the Bronx, and, you know, I was being bused to, and at some point my mother decided she would ride the bus with us, and she just didn't like the rowdiness of the kids, so she took us off the bus, and she would take the train up to Uptown with us every morning and pick us up at 3 o'clock every day and bring us back to the South Bronx.
Wow.
Yeah. And I mean, at that time, the South Bronx was just that. It was the South Bronx. There were burnt out buildings. It was, you know, an area where at that time is where they housed. If you were a black or a Latino, Puerto Rican, that is where you lived at. You didn't really have a choice to live.
No, because you didn't walk through Little Italy at all.
No, they didn't meet you in Uptown Bronx because that was predominantly white, Pelham Parkway,
right,
which is really kind of predominantly white to this day.
Yes.
So I went to school at PS 121 on Throop Avenue and Gun Hill Road. We were being bused there. It was a predominantly black school. And then when I got to the fifth grade, my mother wanted to continue keeping me in that uptown section of the Bronx because the schools were better. I didn't have to be in the, you know, the South Bronx schools, which, you know, they weren't getting the funding that the other schools were getting.
Right. And that was a time when they were cutting out wood shop, metal shop, music classes for budgetary, because they started cutting arts programs in the schools and stuff, too, some of them.
Right. Exactly. And, you know, that's the thing, you know, and thank God she had me go to IS 141, I think it was, Michelangelo School on Allerton Avenue, uptown in the Bronx. And that school was in a predominantly white area and still had a performing arts program.
There you go. Okay. She was smart.
So,
mother's very smart.
And so that's where I started with performing arts. I auditioned for the choir and was accepted, and we had a very good choir instructor, Frida Edmond. She was a black lady, and she was really serious about her choir. And I stayed in that, and I was in a like an SP class that was in the choir. So I stayed in that for from sixth grade to eighth grade. We did performances, and that's really where I got my taste of the poison, you know, liquor, as I would call it.
Okay.
That is where.
But where did you start hearing it? Where was you? Because you didn't have transistor radios and stuff back. And were you going to some of the park stuff or going to some people's parties? How did you start getting a flavor?
Well, the hip hop was not there as we know it. It didn't even exist.
Right.
We were listening to James Brown. You know, all those records that inevitably became part of the hip hop culture.
Right.
We were listening to the records. James Brown was a huge thing for us. I mean, I was a big Beatles fan as well. But we were just listening to those records and dancing. There was no breakdance. There was no MC. There was no real park jams as we know them today.
Right.
So, you know, we would have performances. My parents would always come. And it was a big thing for us, you know. We learned how we were vocally trained. And singing was a huge thing for us. So when I got to the eighth grade, and of course I was graduating, we had to decide what high schools we were going to. And I inevitably ended up going to Harry S. Truman High School in Co-op City, which had just been built at the time.
Wow. Okay.
And Harry S. Truman, when I started going there, they didn't even have a graduating class yet. You know, it was in a predominantly white area, which is Co-op City. And the school itself was new and built in Co-op City with the intention of the kids who were living in Co-op City to attend that school.
Okay.
What my mother had to do was she asked a girlfriend of hers to if she could use her address in the valley so that I could attend Truman High School. So I had to remember this address that really wasn't mine. You know, anytime they asked me something, you know, I had to remember that address on Burke Avenue. I don't remember it today, but I remembered it. You know, I had to remember. My mother was like, now, look, this is the address you have to remember unless you don't want to go.
You
got to
write it down for somebody. Right, I got you.
You got to write it down. So,
your mother was on it. Let me say that. Your mom was on it, okay? she's had all this work done already.
There was my mother and father had rules, and first of all, you had to graduate everything. You had to graduate high school. You had to go to college. You were not coming in this house pregnant with no kids out of wedlock. So to me, that wasn't even, you know, a consideration to me.
Got you.
Like, you know, if I saw someone pregnant, I was like, wow, I'd be in so much trouble. It wasn't even a thought in my mind. So at Truman, and that's where I think it really, that was like the second phase for me. So here I was in junior high school. I was learning how to perform, how to sing, and do performances, and now I'm going to Truman. And once I got to high school in my freshman year, I joined the choir, but their choir was nowhere close to the training I was used to in junior high school.
Mm-hmm.
It was just a class, and, you know, no one was taking it seriously. So I must have did it for one class, and then I was like, forget it, because this is not what I, you know, what I expected it to be.
Right.
But in Truman, I did meet friends, and they were going to be people that were going to, and I didn't know at that time, that were going to be my friends to this day, and they were going to ride this ride with me. To this day, we're still on the same boat riding this ride.
Wow.
And the people that I met in Truman was Raheem from the Furious Five.
Wow.
He was in Truman with me, so I knew Raheem way before he was even with the Funky Four. I mean, Raheem used to walk through the hallways of Truman singing before he
told me that. We interviewed him. You're getting verification, giving verification to the brother's story, because he told me, you know, his little trip was different from Melly Mel and Kid Creole, we used to hang together and stuff. You know what I'm saying? And he told me that. You know what I'm saying? I said, go ahead. I'm sorry. Kimber Reynolds, so y'all, dropping knowledge. Go ahead.
Raheem's mother was a teacher. So, and Raheem, you know, he was one of the youngest, so Raheem had rules he had to follow, just like me. I mean, I'm going to tell you right now, just because we live in those sections of the Bronx, do not believe for a second that all our parents are poor and impoverished, because we weren't.
Wow. Right. Okay. This is refreshing to hear.
We didn't have the opportunities as black people to live in other neighborhoods.
Okay.
Because we weren't accepted in other neighborhoods, so we had to stay where we could be at, and this is where we were at. So I met Raheem there, and then, again, way before he was even with the Funky Four, not the Funky Four Plus One More, the Funky
but
Four,
the Funky
which was
Four.
Their original group. And I also met Shaheem there, which was my ended up to be my bandmate in my group, Infinity Four MCs.
Shaheem
is probably, and most people know him in the industry. Shaheem just doesn't, he's not on any type of social media. I don't know why. I keep saying, Shaheem, open a Facebook page. He just won't do it. But most people know Shaheem because he could be, he is probably one of the world's greatest lyricists in the world.
Wow.
He could ghostwrite for Jay-Z. I mean, this is how talented he is. Even at a young age, he was lyrically gifted. He still is to today. So what happened? I ended up graduating high school at a young age. And I remember when I was going to get my diploma, I don't know if it was Raheem or Shaheem, or it could have been my girlfriend Tracy. They was like, are you sure they have a diploma for you? And I'm like, yes, I am. Like, yes, I may have cut class, but I was in the classes I needed to be in to get my diploma, okay? So I ended up graduating from Truman, and I went away to college. I was like 17.
What year?
78,
okay. Pivotal year, go ahead. Okay.
Okay, well, now you know my age. There you go. So I actually had applied for some colleges, but this one particular college had sent me a letter and asked me to attend based on my SAT scores, because I had pretty good scores. And so I decided to go to SUNY at Albany, which is one of the top universities here in New York for state universities. And within that time, in 78 is when I actually was asked to audition for my group, in which I inevitably became a member of. So that year, 78 was a big turning point for me, because I went back to being that performer I was in junior high school, but now with a whole different new art form. And here's the thing for us was that, you know, they weren't playing any of our music on the radios. We didn't, they were just playing regular
hip hop.
No hip hop on the radios. None. No Sugar Hill Gang. Nothing. Didn't exist.
Okay. Okay.
All we had were tapes. That's it. They would record the parties and sell the tapes. We would see OJ drivers driving around, and OJ and Topaz were cab services we used to use, but they used to have, like, all the new 98 Regencies and everything with the spoke rims. So we would call them, and we would sell tapes to the drivers and other people, and you would hear these cars driving around playing Funky Four, playing, you know, City Four. And that's how you heard it. You didn't hear it on the radio.
That was hip-hop in New York City, the birthplace of hip-hop, before the first record was ever played on the radio. There was a mixtape underground movement. There were rappers. There were MCs. And that was basically the way the whole thing worked. You buy mixtapes. That's how MCs became popular, and their popularity spread through the sale of their tapes.
it wasn't even what we called mixtapes, because in that time it wasn't a mixed tape. It was the Funky Four at the T Connection tape from last week. It was Infinity Four tape from the PAL last week.
Okay.
So they weren't mixed. It would be just a tape of the party.
Of the party or show. Got you. Okay,
right.
That preceded the mix. That preceded mixtapes. This is all fascinating. Okay,
yeah.
This is something you grew up with, but the people outside of New York, what you're saying right now, this is the kind of information that people just don't know. Okay, that even among the mixtape era, before that happened, there was an era that preceded that, where rappers and MCs and their crews were starting to get known, but it was the specific tapes at specific shows. Kimber Reynolds on Disco Daddy's Wide World of Hip Hop, dropping bombs. Continue, young lady, please.
And so, you know, no one heard of hip hop. And it was crazy because at that time, probably the top show at that time was Good Times. You know, Good Times started in the project. You know, everything's happening. Drugs, weed, dope. And so that's what everyone was seeing in America, you know, and that's what they thought about it.
Right.
We love the show, but white people had never seen black people from before. This was their first exposure. Good Times. Wow, they really starving out there, them black people, huh? And it was funny because when I went away to school, I had all white dorm mates. And one of the girls in my dorm, in my suite, her uncle, just to show you what situation I was in, had won the Nobel Peace Prize that year.
Damn.
And I'll never forget, they kind of looked at me like, oh, we have a black here. You know, so I can imagine what they thought of me.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, right. In the Bronx. I got you. Go
right.
ahead. But you were there.
But I was here. Look, they asked me to come.
Right.
I was good enough to be here. I had high enough scores, you know. I didn't apply. They asked me to come.
Right.
So I never see one day, either I had shows that I was doing, because what I was doing, I was coming home on the weekends in 78 to do my shows with my group.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember one time I met a girl from Buffalo. She's a black girl. And it's so funny because I was telling her about hip hop. She had never heard about hip hop. And, you know, I would tell a few my rhymes. And then one day I remember she said to me, "You ever heard of Rick James? Yeah, we got this guy up in Buffalo. His name is Rick James." Now, Rick James didn't even come out yet. And I was like, "Nah, I never heard of no Rick James." You know, Rick James didn't come out to 82 or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
So I never forget. One day my suite mates decided they wanted to throw me out because I was black. And I never forget, one of them came up to me and said to me, "I heard you. I heard you saying those words." What she heard me doing was practicing my rhymes. But she didn't know what it was.
Words? Oh.
Right.
Well, what words? What did she think you were saying?
I don't know. Maybe she thought I was doing some little religious sacrifice or something. But she said it to me. Right. Right.
Okay.
She said, "I heard you saying the word." And then she said, "N word, we want you out." They
just
had to
like
take
that?
Me. Yeah, they had to take me. And I was talking to my mother on the phone at the time. My mother was livid. I hung up the phone.
She
my
heard
mother
that?
Called me back. Huh?
She heard that?
My mother hung up because I was on the phone with her at the time.
Wow.
Yeah. So they ended up moving me in the middle of the night to another dorm with all black girls.
Wow.
And one of the girls was from Harlem, so I was really comfortable there. But then what ended up happening was I was going home so much to do shows that I ended up not going back because it started to snowball. The shows started getting more frequent, and hip-hop started to become really popular, whereas we were like, wow, maybe we can really – you know,
let's segue into that. What did you start? What did you start doing hip hop wise that drew you into what's now our culture? How did you start getting? Where did you start touching the turntables? You were a DJ, right?
No, I was an MC. Oh, see, you got to learn
MC,
your history.
I'm sorry. Okay, right. I'm sorry. Well, how did that? That's what I'm saying. How did that happen? So you're going
on. Well, that happened once I joined the group. Once hip hop, once everyone's, the MC started, like Cowboy started MCing. And see, I lived in Castle Hill, and so I was close by DJ Afrika and Bambaataa and the Zulu Nation, Disco wow. King Mario, who was from Bronxdale. So when I was 15 yeah. years old, way before I even got to, before anything happened, breakdancing started first. So when I was 15, I used to go to Bronxdale to see Cookie and Clement, and we would learn how to breakdance, and we was, you know, battling each other at parties. But
oh,
we didn't have the party. Right, I was
you
a B-girl.
Okay,
right.
So you started,
we didn't
I was a B-girl.
Have the party
okay.
as we know them now. Like, there were no MCs right. on the mic. The purpose of the DJ was to extend the beat so that we can break dance and have these, you know, our crew would
right.
break dance against you. And if I broke dance and I burnt you, which meant that I was better than you, then I won.
Wow. Okay.
We used to say, ooh, she got burned, she got burned. Yeah, that meant that you wasn't as good as the person you was break dancing against.
Did you run against, did you run into or know MC Sharon Sharrock during that period?
No, not when I was 15. Because
okay.
she was, I think Shaw was in Lambert. She may have still been in Lambert. And that was a little further from where I was at. Because I was uptown.
Okay, because she was a B-girl too. So there were different sections you guys would dance basically at the things going on in your area where you grew up then,
right.
basically.
Right.
Okay.
I think the time that we really, what made us all interconnect was when the MC group started. And what happened was there were no female MCs. There were just a handful of us in the Bronx. Just
right.
a handful. Regardless of what anyone says, it started in the Bronx. And the handful of female MCs I can name to you now. Of course, there were the Mercedes Ladies.
Right.
They were the first and only female group.
Okay.
And we have Lisa Lee of the Zulu Nation, and they were close to me because that was Bronx
okay.
River.
Right.
And then there was Sha Rock, who was with the Funky Four. But see, my bandmate, which was Shaheem, who went to Truman with me, he lived next door on the same street as DJ Baron, who was Sha Rock's DJ. So that's how I learned, that's how I really got introduced to the Funky Four, because I would go to Shaheen's house and DJ Baron would be at the house and
okay,
come on.
Okay, DJ Baron, is that Baron Breakout or the same or there's two people, two different people?
Yes, DJ Baron and DJ Breakout, Brothers and Sisters Disco.
Wow, okay. Wow.
So that's how I met them and became really close with them, because Shaheem lived right next to them, although he went to school uptown in the Bronx. So what would happen, I would, you know, when I was performing with Infinity Four MCs or Grand Mixer DST and DJ Little Quick, we would, you know, do shows, I think, you know, and at that time, the most popular place in the very beginning, and people don't understand, the PAL, as much as they hate hip-hop right now, the Police Athletic League.
Yeah, okay.
Webster Avenue was where we did all our jams. I still have flyers, if you look on Facebook, from 1978-79 at the PAL.
So were they earlier, the earliest that you recall with the formation of Bronx hardcore, what would later become some of your stars coming out of there, the Grandmaster Flashes and all of that? That was that
right.
the center of that?
Well, see, at that time, that's when it all formed. It formed right there at that time with those groups. The groups were always.
What year are you talking about? What year time frame?
78, 79. That
okay.
is when MC was really born. The group, the organized group, where we had shows and routines, that's when it was born.
Wow, okay.
So at that time, I had four members in my group, which is Shaheem. He was our captain, and every group has a captain.
What was the name of your group?
Infinity Four MCs.
Infinity Four, okay. One female MC and three guys, or how was that?
Right. I mean, it was great because, I mean, you know, I went to high school with Shaheem, so I knew him, and they were just like big brothers to me, just like they are today. So, I mean, I didn't get any play from anyone. They kept
putting you up. No problem with putting you up front, a female or anything like that.
I think there's always a little jealousy, but then, you know, it's cool because they were guys, and I always felt competitive within my own group.
Okay.
Because I had to deal with Shaheen, and I'm my captain.
They respected your skills, obviously. They had respect for your skills, obviously.
They had mad respect, but Shaheen was a lyrical genius, so I always felt I had to compete with him within the group.
Wow. Okay.
But they liked that because then after a while they would say, ooh, you're trying to compete with us. I can tell because you're getting real nasty in the rhymes right now.
So were you calling yourself Kimber Reynolds? Were you the same name or did you have a different DJ name? Or is that your
Well,
DJ?
Reynolds was my last name. Reynolds is my last name. So I was never used my last name. It was just Kimber.
Kimber, okay.
And we were all known as MC whatever. Because before the rapper, quote unquote, there was the MC, the master of the ceremony.
Right.
And so even today, I would never consider myself a rapper because an MC is just a total different ball game. Rappers are usually, you know, listen, if I had to battle someone, like, I don't have, you know, now it's just they records, you know what I'm saying? They don't have no rhymes. They don't have a book of rhymes where they can go in and say, okay, I'm going to throw a few battle rhymes. I'm going to throw, yeah, that new joint I wrote. You know what I'm saying? It's like a different.
Yeah. Oh, I know. Yes, it is.
It's very different. But so my group, we did. I mean, we battled so many different people. I think we battled Jazzy J, Africa Islam, Rock and Rob. We played at the D Connection, and we did a lot of other things too. We also decided to go up to Westchester County, and we battled the Collins brothers. We also ended up in Connecticut. There's a DJ up there called Terrible T, and we used to battle them a lot. So we did a lot of traveling. We kind of ventured out beyond the five boroughs as well.
Okay, now let me ask you. Records started being made. You guys right on the cusp. How did that change the game, and what happened as far as you guys ever trying to be approached for a record deal? What happened all of a sudden when records started being made? When at first either King Kim or Rapper's Delight got on the air and this contract, or now we can get record contracts. What happened?
Well, I know at one time when Sugar Hill came up, had came out, because Enjoy came out before Sugar Hill did.
Right.
And when Sugar Hill had came into place, DST had let us know that they were talking about us coming on board with Sugar Hill, but DST was like, nah. For some reason, he just didn't want to be on the Sugar Hill label, which was kind of a good thing, but in a way it wasn't, because those who went on Sugar Hill, inevitably, they still have lawsuits against Sugar Hill to this day trying to get their royalties, which they never got.
Right. But at the same time, they did get some fame, was able to travel the world and get, you know what I'm saying, make money that way. I mean, you know, it's a two-edged sword. What I'm saying?
Right. So they got the accolades of making that record because they went. But then, you know, we did go into the studio a few times. We did do recordings, but they ended up not being pressed. I think Bam has one of them. And if I can get my hands on it, it would be great. I mean, I have old tapes of us that we don't even circulate. The only reason why we don't circulate our old tapes is because we don't want them for everyone to have them in their hands, and we're just not getting paid for it. So what we did was we agreed that we would hold on to the tapes that we have and wait for the right moment, the right opportunity.
Call Cornell University, you know, Miss Katherine Reagan up there. That's the kind of stuff you can donate to the museums and people to make sure that your stories are still around and viable, you know. We've got a few minutes left. I want people to know what Kimber Reynolds is doing now, where they can find you, and how your life has turned out since. And what do you think about the state of hip-hop right
now? I mean, look, I don't like the hip-hop from the South. It's like mumble music, bunny hop music. I mean, no disrespect to them, but to me it's just not – it's trap music. And I think that trap music and hip-hop should be two separate categories. They shouldn't be the same because they're not.
That's interesting. Okay.
I think trap music, which is like a drug house, y'all could keep that. We want hip-hop to be in its purest form. I mean, I'll tell you right now, I love hip-hop from New York. Any New York MCs, Jay-Z's album that came out, forget about it. The OJ, story of OJ, that's so deep, it's retarded.
Wow, okay.
If you don't get what he's saying on that, that means you are just in a whole nother realm. You haven't even gotten to that enchilant where he's at now, thinking differently. You know, I love that. My favorite MC of all the time is always going to be Ghostface Killah.
Okay. Wow.
Ghostface Killah is the only MC that I know that don't have no hooks, and he MC like a real MC through the whole record. You know,
okay,
so I love
you're hearing this from a true queen of the culture, a lady who should know what she's talking about. Ms. Kimber Reynolds, I could talk to you for hours. And we're going to do some more interviews in the future. We're working out in the television and stuff like that. So I'm sort of laying the foundation with these interviews now so you guys can see how Disco Daddy does it. But we honor you as a true queen of hip-hop culture. We respect your contribution to hip-hop culture. Okay, and we want people to know your story. If you didn't know about Kimber Reynolds, you know a little bit more about her now. Any books or anything planned, Kimber?
I have a book planned shortly, and I'll get to you and let you know when it's come out. Make sure you get a free copy. I do work with Jam Master Jay's family concerning Jam Master Jay stuff. I was their COO, so I've done, you know, they got the Lifetime Grammy Achievement Award. Jay just received that last year in Los Angeles.
Wow.
I was out there for that. He got inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame right after, you know, my brother Raheem did. Raheem Furious 5, of course, was the first inducted, but they got inducted after that, and I was there for that.
Wow.
I mean, you know, I do other things. Right now, I do contractual work, like for Cat Team, so they're out there suffering in Texas. I know I got to run out there in the next couple of days and help the people in Texas. You know, otherwise. Oh, yes, I'm on Facebook. Kimber Reynolds on Facebook. I am on Instagram, The Real Kimber, and I am also on Twitter, The Real Kimber.
All right. We love having you on our show. Nothing but the best. And again, y'all, this has been Kimber Reynolds, true queen of hip-hop culture, on Disco Daddy's Wide World of Hip-Hop. Peace.
Peace.
So wasn't it a great show? Come back next week, every Saturday at 1 p.m. Pacific Time, 3 p.m. Central Time, 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, Disco Daddy's Wide World of Hip Hop Show. Man, it's a great one. Epic, epic. See you next week. Bye.
You're listening to Vibes Live Radio with Robin Lynn.